So welcome back to this last round, the function of this is to kind of put things together. We had these three, or you had these three breakout sessions, and we have the three rapporteurs here to tell us, kind of give us a summary, a report of what has been said. And the way we're going to do it is we go for the groups 1, 2, 3, and after each kind of talk, we'll have a bit of question and answering session. So we start with Mr. Hugo Miguel. He's the Undersecretary of Planning, Ministry of Communications of Argentina. You have the word. It seems to be working now, actually.
Yeah. Hello? Yes?
Yes.
Okay. I will talk about the main issues related during the panel. Concerning the regulation, we revealed the necessity to assure the rights over the information obtained by innovators with their own applications. In parallel way, the sharing of common information produced of the use of the systems, and both in the market, in the framework of a data project, the protection system. Another point was the impact of the digital environment in the economy, with the discussion of if it assists two economies, digital and real, or the real economy includes the digital. We need the tracking of the value chain in the cost analysis, the national and the internal taxes, logistics, heavy and light logistics, and the impact in the definition of the pricing. All the process of pricing and the necessity of to develop models with identifications of variables. Another important point related to the financing of this new environment are the situation of the banks, that they are not prepared to assume the new role in the digital environment, the evaluation of model of business, the models of free business and side business when you are developing a marketplace where you are not obtaining money for that, but the money comes from side business, the necessity to increase the amount of users, the creation of a complete framework that includes the digital ecosystem integrated with the business models, to provide a continuity of the document defined by the G20's previous sessions, and summarizing the questions that we used to promote the discussion. In the question 1 and 2, that were the comparative analysis between the competence in the old model of business against the new one, the definition of need of new ways, new models of competitions or co-petitions, cooperative competition or complementary competition. In the question 3, related with financing, the adoption of regulations for the new reality and to help to the financial sector to assume the risks or to evaluate the new risk of the new environment. And in the question 4, related, what is the better support to adoption the digital technologies is the education. And so the need to support education to assure the knowledge that we need to move in this new environment.
Thanks, Hugo. I think one of your questions also included included kind of a sideway to competition and antitrust. I mean, did that come up? Did you have any kind of suggestions whether that should be included in the roadmap? And if yes, what was that?
The discussion related with the competition was, as I said, the necessary to understand the difference of the different weight of the competition, because the new competitions we are needs to share not only information but infrastructure. So in some cases it's competition. It's a cooperative competition, because we are sharing part of the infrastructure and sharing part of databases, and the difference is made with the use of different intelligence over the data that we obtain. No matter who obtains the data, the issue is how we can analyze the data. Mm-hmm.
And I quickly said in your session, and there was one thing I think actually discussed not heatedly, but I mean intensely. It was kind of financing, venture capitalism, how to help kind of give startups money. So how did that go? I mean, did you come to any conclusion what the
yes,
G20
the
can do?
The conclusion related that was when I said when I talk about the issue of the new framework for the banks, or how we can encourage the bank to have a new view over the risk analysis to promote the use of funds in these new kind of activities. Because we come from old views of the business models, and the new business models are a problem to evaluate the risk that they want to take. So we need to encourage the banks with the regulation to assure the use of the funds in this new economy. One of the issues in the new economy is what is new and what is fake. That's the case of the bubbles, the internet bubble, or the dot-com bubbles, where there was not, in some cases, technology matters, and was standard business or no business at all with the makeup of technology. So this is a point to be very precise in the definition of the model, of the business model.
Mm. And of all what you've heard, kind of, is there anything that stood out, kind of, that you think really has to be in the roadmap for it to be good?
In the case of financial?
No, generally, for what you've heard generally during your session.
I think we need to put in the roadmap the use of the data, the data protection and security, the new rules for this economy, for this digital environment, and education.
When you say use of the data, do you mean kind of mandatory access or to certain types of data, or how should I understand that?
In one of the discussions that I maintained in the panel, we explained that I understand there are two kinds of data to be shared. One is the data that is common, produced by any one of us when we are using the systems. That data is the data produced without is out of the management of the people that use the network. The network produces data and gives information about the people. And other thing is the confidentiality of the data that you maintain in a private conversation. You have one level of link between the correspondents in one conversation where the data is untouchable. But at the same time, when you are registering in the network and you are generating a lot of metadata related with the communications, is another thing that is able to be shared, and we need to assure the common use of the data that we produce during the conversation. Not the data inside, it's the data, complementary data that is produced in the conversation. Those are two different levels. In the same case, is the data produced with one particular application. If I am an innovator, I define a new way to make a business, and we obtain in the process data proper from the definition of the business, that is proprietary data. But the data related with the use of the network and the pass of the information through the routers or through the base stations or the access of the radio links to the cellular network is common data, is part of the digital environment, and the idea is to promote the use, because the innovation is not to store the data, is to apply different models of meta-analysis and analysis and analytics over that data, are different models of business.
Thank you very much. So let me open this up to the audience. So any questions to Hugo or any additional remarks if you have attended that session, something which hasn't been mentioned? Again, there's kind of roaming microphones over there.
We have had in the discussion more at the end, talked about that we need stakeholders, all the stakeholders which are necessary for this discussion to bring in their points, their themes. And under this, what I said, that the gender aspect is really important, which hadn't been mentioned here except by Ms. Gordon. Thank you.
Thank you. Any more questions on this, on group number one? Okay, that's not the case. So next up is Shirley Zhang. She is Department Director at the China Academy of Information and Communication Technology.
I'm from the group two. Our group discussed the developing approach to standard and the digital infrastructure. Actually, there are two topics. It's quite similar with this morning section. One is that we all noticed that we need to encourage the SME participants to the standards and the architecture activities. So another one is that standard has played an important role for the digital economic. Actually, during our discussion, that we found that our architecture is quite technical. We use the technical languages. Actually, we need to encourage the simplified language to make the SME to easy understand what is the architecture and how they can find the useful information for them. And I think that G20 can encourage the simplified the language to reduce the barriers for SME participants in the digital, in the standard activities, in the architecture, and also the digital economic activities. During the discussion, we also found that there are multiple architecture initiatives related to the Industry 4.0, such as China, USA, and Japan. They all have the architecture framework. So from that point of view, that we can encourage these architectures to work together to share the information and to identify the common element of the architecture, such as we can adopt the principle of the interoperability to define the interface. And this is important that to share the information between the different architectures. And during the discussion, we also found that set up the target for the broadband access is quite helpful for the development of the digital infrastructure. We also noticed that there are still the gap between different areas. So we also talk about the solution to reduce the gaps. Actually, we found we can encourage the competition between the different operators, and we can use the PPP model to invest and construct the infrastructure. And we also encourage the different technical approach for the different scenarios. So this we found, what we found during the broadband discussion, which is covered the digital infrastructure. Actually, we also talk about the best practice. Actually, we got the conclusion that we can share the information among G20 members about the best practice. It will be useful for the SMEs and also for the members to promote the digital economy. So this is the what we conclude from the group two. Thank you.
Thank you, Shirley. I mean, I also spent some time in your session, and what I found interesting, there was a debate about whether governments or the G20 should play a role at all in kind of standard setting processes, because there's already so much going on. Also, you could ask, I mean, yes, there's different architectures for, let's say, IoT and industry 4.0, but that's perhaps a good thing because there's competition. So. What was kind of the consensus? I mean, did people say, yes, we want the G20 to be active in that area? And yes, how? What would be the kind of the best way of doing that?
Yes, I think that we need to, for the different architectures, I think we got the answers. Yes, it's to, we need to share the information about the different architectures, and we all know that the architecture is quite important to help the people got some common understanding about what is the industry internet or industry 4.0. We even talk about the how is the standard or the architecture can be used, or is it necessary for the SMEs, and we got the yes answer. Yeah, it's quite important, and it's very helpful for the SME to understand the technology and understand the position of the there in the whole picture. So I think it's the active conclusion for the architecture sharing.
Thank you. Again, any remarks on that? Anything you want to add, you want to ask? Over there.
Yes, Justin Robichaud from Canada. I guess I was wondering if you had a bit of a discussion on what kind of standards is required at the moment, given this is such a... Industry 4.0, a work in progress. Where have you had a discussion on where they see the requirement for establishing standards at this stage?
Okay, I think during the group discussion, our common understanding is that standard is important for the activities, and we are not, I think, for the among the G20 members, it's important to share the information to have the standard ecosystem is important. It's not the detailed, exactly specified standards to formulate it by G20. So I think that the important is the role of the standard and the ecosystem for the standard, such as we will encourage the SME to participate in the standards.
Thank you. And any more questions? Okay, let's move on to the third group. David Ringrose, he is head of unit policy outreach and international affairs at the European Commission and DG Connect, I think, more specifically.
So we all use the same one. That's good. So I tried to put down the points here on some slides. I think we had a very good discussion on a lot of issues because I think everybody agreed that trust is important across the board.
How do I press? It never works.
There we go. On the program, we were asked to answer three questions. The first one, what would a roadmap look like? And I think the one word that we all agreed was inclusive. And this was an important word, not because not only for the credibility of the actions, but also that whatever we are proposing to implement, it needs to be involved all stakeholders at all times. I think this morning the discussion talked about that in general, but there were a lot of issues that were raised on all of the sort of the trust and security, privacy, consumer protection issues, where inclusivity and involving stakeholders at all stages of the process was held to be very important, and where it doesn't work, it's maybe because we haven't done that. So in answer to the first question, just one word, it needs to look inclusive. The next point, what sort of policy options and principles? I think principles, we isolated three: fairness, transparency, and accountability. I think fairness is an important point that was raised again in a lot of issues, given the importance of the digital economy, jobs, and so on, that we need to, that there needs to be, fairness needs to be a guiding principle there. Transparency, underpinning a lot of the debates, not only particularly the very consumer-facing debates that where people need to understand what it is that they're doing. Just because they're doing something doesn't mean they trust it. It would be, and also in terms of transparency, we need to be clear what we're talking about. Transparency doesn't just mean more information. It's also about the processes and about how people feel when they're involved in the economy and so on. And accountability, an important issue, because on the one hand, a lot of people saying that consumers need to be responsible, but on the other hand, consumers should not be responsible for things they're not responsible for. Other people need to be responsible. Companies also can't be responsible for everything. We need to see what they're accountable for. Governments need to be responsible and need to be accountable as well. So, but in a lot of the discussions, it's often not clear, and the decisions that people are taking often seem to blur who should be accountable. And on what sort of options we're talking about, one issue, for example, very important for establishing trust was portability, for example, that there's nothing better for the adoption of a product than if people know they can change. If they know they can't change, that perhaps diminishes the amount of trust that people have, although portability is a very slippery concept and it's often very difficult to define and to put into practice. But if you have your telephone, you're very happy if you know you can change provider and so on. And interoperability, again, across lots of areas, whether it was interoperability between digital security strategies, interoperability between systems, between platforms, and so on, that these are very important issues for establishing trust and security. And the third point, how can the OECD, the G20, the OECD digitalization project best support the policy options? And I think it was clear in a lot of the discussions, measurement is important. I think Andrew said it sounds very OECD, but we need to stress that you need to have data. But I think a lot of people said very clearly that a lot of the judgments that we're making in policy areas are not yet made on the basis of sound data. A lot of the issues are related to the novelty of what we're trying to measure. We're trying to measure new things. One of the things, for example, measuring trust itself, an indicator for trust, is a very difficult thing, but it would be very useful to be able to try to do so. Competencies and skills. We often talk about skills gaps, skill, and so on. What skills are we talking about? Do we know what skills people have, what they should have, and so on? Behaviors as well. A lot of the time we're making judgments about issues when it comes down to actual behavior. I think it was talked about this morning that we have to understand how people behave, and maybe a lot of platforms and so on are much better at figuring out how people behave than people making policy. Data flows, again, the measurement of data flows is still very unclear. We're not sure exactly what cross-border data flows are, how many there are, and so on, and it's an area we have to be very careful about. The jobs number as well, as we said, a lot of the time we say that the digital economy is putting in danger jobs, but as Tim O'Reilly said this morning, a lot of the jobs we don't know about yet. We need to look at, have our data about the extent to which data, the digital economy is creating jobs, the extent to which it's replacing jobs, and so on. So one very clear way in which the project can support the policy challenges is to work across all of these areas to try to measure them, not only because they're important in themselves, but because all of these things underpin trust in the process. If you can't tell people with some credibility about the impact on jobs, or if you can't tell people what the data flows are, then the credibility of your the people's trust in your policy options may be diminished. There we are.
Thank you, David. One question. I mean, a couple of things you said, like data portability and kind of giving consumers control, pointed to this nascent debate of data ownership or property rights for data. I mean, did that explicitly come up? And if yes, how was it discussed?
Yeah, I think it came up as a very complicated issue. A lot of people say this is very good. Everybody should we should work on portability. But firstly, there's a lot of work that needs to be done in terms of understanding what type of data we're talking about, who owns it, what about commercial data, personal data, is there a difference, should there be a difference, different people working on it, defining it in different ways. Portability may be fine, but if you have portability of your portability of your playlist on Spotify may be very easy to define, but portability of all of your data on a social collaboration platform, is your data only the content you uploaded? Is it the content that involves you that other people put there? Is it the content that you liked, and so on? So a lot of these things are very, very complicated, and but I think it was very clear that a feeling that data can be portable and that people are in control would be a very important boost to trust and credibility, but defining it in all of these areas is extremely, extremely complicated.
Thanks, David. Again, kind of let me open it up to the audience. Any additional questions over there?
Thank you. This is Suso Baleato from the civil society stakeholder at the OECD Committee on the Digital Economy. I wanted to thank for the excellent summary of this interesting session, and I just wanted to emphasize what our colleague has just commented, and also building on the input and the comment from the US at this slot, at this discussion, on the expression was bringing stakeholders on the table. This is absolutely important, because if we bring stakeholders on the table, we will be able to improve the quality of the recommendations and the outcomes and the discussions that we will be taking, that the G20 will be taking, and also by involving stakeholders, there will be a higher chance of effective implementation of the decisions and the recommendations that will be taken there, because all the different opinions and information will be included. So this is what I wanted to emphasize, the importance of having this, improving this stakeholder engagement. Of course, the G20 will need to develop its own model. Several models of multi-stakeholder engagement exist. We have the IGF stakeholder engagement model. We have the technical bodies multi-stakeholder engagement model. But we have a real good multi-stakeholder engagement model, which is the one which has been developed by the OECD at the Committee on the Digital Economy Policy. This has proved to be an effective way to involve all the stakeholders, even those from civil society, from NGOs, scholars worldwide, to effectively contribute in a constructive way, so to improve these policies and to have these recommendations decided and designed incorporating all the different views. And I'm not talking only about civil society, I'm of course talking about business, I'm talking about labor unions, I'm talking about the technical community. We are very thankful of having the opportunity to be here and sharing our views, but we should really go further and improve this model. So I was a proponent in the slot to not reinvent the wheel, for example, in the work of privacy and the work of cryptography, on the work of security, where the OECD has proved to be able to define the leading recommendations and frameworks on that. And the OECD model on stakeholder engagement could be a really useful one for the G20 to implement this kind of participation. So thank you very much, and yep.
Thank you. And any more questions? Over there.
Thank you. Joseph Aladef, I chair the BIAC Committee on the Digital Economy Policy. And I just wanted to react to the last statement you had made on data portability and the importance of understanding the complexity, because too often data portability is considered just an analog to cell number portability. And the complexity in data portability is substantially higher because, for instance, in a cloud service, some of the feature and function that may differentiate one service from another means that that feature and function is not portable to another service, even though the data may very well be easily portable through an acceptable data standard that can be moved. The last thing is, because of that differentiation, it may not be possible for one provider to accomplish the transfer for you, but rather to make the transfer available to you. And we believe that there are going to be intermediaries that develop to help facilitate the transfers to bridge any complexity that may occur in the transfer. So we need to think about the dynamics of that ecosystem and how it may evolve, and not just go to a knee-jerk, oh, well, cell numbers are portable, so therefore everything else should be portable. And that, I don't mean to imply that's what the comments indicated, but I do want to highlight that caution.
Thank you very much. And any more questions? That is not the case. So I want to give the panel the chance to kind of one concluding remark, anything you stood out in what you've heard now and what you've heard during your sessions, what any pitfalls to avoid?
I think that, at least speaking for this session, yeah. It was a very, very rich session, and I think with contributions from all sides of the debate, and I think bringing out the point about bringing on the stakeholders, it was very interesting to see the degree of convergence on analysis of the problem, so, which is very important, even though not everybody has the same solutions, but it was. I think the inclusivity point was one that was made across a lot of the things, because this is a very complex area, and unless we get it right, we're much more likely to make mistakes than to produce good policy, I guess.
Thank you. Hugo?
Yes, concerning the points of the stakeholders, I think it's very important, the participation, but our governments are working in several forums where the stakeholders are part, like the IGF forum or the technical forum. This is a forum of 20 countries, and we are discussing about the policy of the countries based in the experience that we have in the discussion with the stakeholders in other forums, and it's only the point of view that we have in the matters that we discuss in this point. It's not a forum that want to exclude something of the discussion. We are integrated discussions, and there are some parts that are not internet. For example, the use of networks, the assure of the availability of the networks is not internet. So it's part of the regulations that the country needs to deploy to assure the communications to the people. So it's very interesting, the discussion is very, it's welcome, all the comments and the observations, but there are particular forums to participate as a stakeholder and particular forums to participate as government.
Thanks. Shirley?
So for the group two, I would like to say thank you for all of the supporting from the participant, and they contribute a very active discussion and very helpful suggestion for the topic of standard and the infrastructure. Actually, from the group, we can see that the simple language and the facility tools are really very helpful to the SMEs. And we can see the standard and the architecture actually play a very important role in the digital economic activities. And we also see from the discussion that in sharing information among the members is quite helpful such as the best practice and the multiple architecture to find the common elements. So it will be encouraged among the members to sharing the information. They are quite helpful for the SME to understand and to develop their business quite rapidly. So that is for the group two. Thank you.
So thank you very much to the panelists. Give them a hand. That was great. We now move on to kind of the last part of this conference. To wrap it up, we'll have concluding remarks, first by Andy Wyckoff and then by Stefan Schnoor, who is the Director General of this ministry.